Kench is an interesting one, but it's actually towards, I believe, the top laner there.
Yeah, it's towards Evie instead of Dara, because Evie's one of the few players that actually played Tahm Kench top, I believe. Yeah, either way, taking that off the table prevents the protective abilities of the champion, the ability to save somebody who's in some trouble, as Cassiopeia is banned away from Rampage. They're saying, hey, you want to target our mid laner? We'll go ahead and throw one back at yours.
Now these last few bans are the ones that really matter here for me, because what are you rounding this out with to make sure that they don't have a certain something? Let's see what this one is from Red Canids. I don't think you ban something like Ivern or, you know, one of those champions that'll help you out with protection.
Zyra.
Okay.
Respecting the support position, keeping that one away from Dara.
It means they want to have some type of winning bottom lane here for themselves.
And that's their strategy, right? That's what they want to do. You get BRTT ahead, give him a way that he can be powerful going into the mid game. Give Diu the ability to support him properly through whatever tool, whatever support he needs to pick for that from that wide champion pool.
Yeah.
Lulu, the final ban from the side of Rampage. Ivern still up, but the Red Canids decide to go for Malzahar instead.
Ooh, okay. Interesting, because Malzahar actually took a few nerfs in the patches that we didn't get to see the NALCS play on, where now he actually has less armor than before, and his Voidlings only have 2 HP instead of 3. So a hit from an AD carry and support will kill them, instead of having those special supports like Lulu, who can now actually one-shot them by herself.
On the side of Rampage, they're going to go ahead, lock in the Varus for bottom lane, picking up Lee Sin for the jungle as well. Tussle didn't have the greatest game on Lee Sin in Rampage's first game of the day. He had an all right performance. He was actually 2-0-2 at the start, starting off strong, but he just wasn't able to find opportunities to get those kicks and those setups that he needed later on.
Yeah, and this will be interesting as well to see Yutori on this champion. It was banned against him by Supermassive, so they knew something here. But we'll see if Red Canids, what happens in that bottom lane, because both these teams kind of want to have that strong bottom lane up against each other. The Malzahar and the Ashe locked in. Two Malzahar, or champions that you'd like to play into Malzahar with the Zyra and the Lulu already banned away, means that you're kind of looking at something like a Karma here for Dara, or possibly a Bard if he does play that champion and could bring it out.
Bottom lane and jungle picked up for the Canids at the start of this draft before the second wave of bans will hit. I'll have to see if Rampage wants to respond in kind, lock in their support now, or if they're comfortable just waiting and risking a couple more bans being targeted towards them before getting around to that pick for Dara. They will wait on it, lock in the Taliyah for Ramine instead.
We had seen that he was 3-0 on this champion in the LJL. This will make it 3-1 for the year because he lost the previous match. And he did pick it in the same spot. So the Japan team had already played. Last time they had picked in the order 1-2-3, Ashe, Lee Sin, Taliyah. Varus, Lee Sin, Taliyah now. So you're seeing a little bit of their priority where all junglers up, Lee Sin. Mid laners up, except for Syndra and Cassiopeia. They go for the Taliyah. Kind of getting a glimpse into the minds of Rampage right now.
What they like, what they don't, what their tendencies are. Echo banned away by them. I believe we also saw this in the previous match.
Yeah.
Banning the Echo away so the Taliyah doesn't have to deal with that. Galio banned away by the Red Canids. There's what you were talking about. There's that ban away the shielding and the supporting capabilities.
Yeah, but I don't think anybody's really going to go for a support the AD carry composition here. Renekton banned out means Camille could be on the table. Fizz, another great top laner. And we're seeing Fizz, Rumble, Camille all on the table, as well as Shen still.
A lot of choices and only one ban left to remove one of them. Fizz is the decision coming out from the Red Canids. Rampage still needs to find themselves a support and a top laner. One of those, of course, will get to be the last pick of the draft, meaning they can pick it into knowing their entire the entire composition of their enemy's team. They decide to go potentially for the Shen here, hovering it for now.
I so feel like you go Shen here blind and last pick your support, or you pick your support into knowing what the Malzahar Ashe bottom lane is going to be, and then you last pick your top laner, unless you had something that you couldn't play into the Shen, if you feel like Shen has no counters that are available at the moment. But I still feel like Gragas on the table is a decent enough champion you could play into it, and there's some other things out there too. Oh, okay.
Oh, if that gets locked in. Oh, man. Come on.
5 seconds.
You can do it. Yeah!
There it is.
All right. You can hear the crowd. They're just as excited as I am, man. Darius locked in for the Red Canids. Zyrene, it's been 2 hours. And I already love MSI 2017,
yeah, dude.
Man. We're getting to see Galios. We're getting to see Darius's. We've seen
Jinx.
Thresh.
It's like all over
Jinx.
The place.
It's all kinds of crazy things. And we're going to see yet another one. Brand picked up as the support for Rampage. Ahri, the mid laner, locked in for the candidates as well that we didn't touch on just yet.
Yeah, so once again, we're going to see an assassin here in the mid lane for Talkers. He had the Cinder previously, kind of that assassin control mage hybrid. But the Ahri up against the Taliyah, it's a matchup that I believe was just played, yes it was, by Ramune. Did an okay job in it in terms of CS in the lane. Roaming wasn't really on point, and he had a kind of a struggle there. But now, no more Protect the AD Carry comps.
No.
That's not what we're seeing here.
Darius does not protect AD carries.
Nope. We're seeing brutal bot lanes. We're seeing mid laners that want to roam, early action junglers, and then we're seeing this top lane where that's the big discrepancy here, is you have a Darius who's just looking to kind of smash your face in, and then you have a Shen who's looking to protect somebody else on your team.
Now, the thing about the Darius is a lot of times you see people try to camp him, try to gank him early because of his low mobility, but you've also got to respect the fact that especially once he hits level 6, this is a very capable 1v2 champion if you don't do it cleanly. And I'm really looking forward to seeing how good he plays the champion, how adept he is at it, how experienced he is with it, because it's a champion you do get to see so very little of.
Yeah, and that means you only basically pull it out when you have full confidence in yourself in that matchup. A carry top laner like this in the group stages up against Evie, who was showing in that last game on the Gragas that he knows how to actually play that top lane and play it like a carry. But he is on that Shen. They blind picked the Shen thinking there wasn't really too much to play into it. And it seems like Darius is the comfortable answer here.
And by the way, Robo has not played Darius at all during the regular split for CB LoL.
Man,
this is
like,
not something that he's falling back on that he's done time and time before. And he's got Dreadnova Darius. This is going to be even cooler.
Man, we got Dreadnova sellouts. We got the Carl's Jr. sellouts.
We're just selling out the whole stream, Zyrene. But it's cool. That is a really cool looking skin.
It's really, really cool. I actually wonder how much he plays it with that skin normally, or if this is just a, you know, because it costs you the shards that you have to open.
Yeah, you got
to
get gemstones, so you've got to have a bunch of boxes. So maybe it's just like, hey, you know what? We're on Tournament Realm.
Yeah.
We got all this stuff unlocked. We might as well use it.
Might as well.
I'm starting with the Doran's Blade as well there in the top lane.
That's aggro. Okay.
Aggressive as possible is Nephon and Tussle getting into a little bit of a tussle of their own here. Tussle having to back away as Robo comes dangerously close, and he doesn't want anything to do with that.
And the Darius into Shen can be quite good. You can outplay the Shen taunt with your E. And the fact that him building resistances really doesn't stuff you too much.
Right.
Darius
got true damage.
Exactly. The Darius has true damage with the ultimate, but also his passive of his E gives him armor penetration. You rush a Black Cleaver, which applies stacks on physical damage, which means when somebody bleeds, you'll eventually hear that crack where their armor is completely shredded and max. So he actually has multiple ways to shred your armor that'll stack up quite quickly. It makes it so that you're still kind of squishy even when you're building defensively against him.
And let's not forget, one of Shen's biggest defensive tools is the Spirit's Refuge, the dodge zone, as everybody knows it. But Darius' damage, it's actually a lot of spell damage. You've got the bleed coming in. You've got the decimate doing a lot of your damage. Auto attacks, yeah, you auto attack them and then you get your reset with your crippling strike, but the Spirit's Refuge won't protect you from everything.
Yeah, and you also got to know how to play against it, because right now, Evie is actually taking a lot of trades in that top side of the map, taking a decent amount of damage.
And the, oh, very, very
tip
the blade on that axe.
That refreshes it too.
And remember that once Robo has 5 stacks of bleed on you, he gets a massive AD steroid for the next few seconds. So if he does hit that last decimate, it's going to hurt even more.
Exactly. There's some great things to keep in mind as well for Darius, where if you get those 5 stacks, and this is why he's so good at 2v1s, you get those 5 stacks on one person, next person you hit, instant 5 stacks. And that's how you get the combos going with the ultimate.
Robo in control of this lane very heavily right now, 11 CS compared to 1.
And this is going to be interesting too, because one of the nerfs to Shen was they took away the bonus damage to non-champions from his Q. So it's harder to last hit under turret. And look at this, Nappon coming top. No sleeping today, not going to nap on this. Going to go
right for a kill. They actually want to make this dive happen. Robo, the one tanking the turret, flashes out of it and gets first blood for his jungler.
You have the Elise. She's so great at turret diving. Even though Evie did his damnedest, he actually got a double taunt, more than you could hope for there. But he flashes in a position where he's still getting his enemies out of the turret range. Not perfectly played it all. But now they know.
Listen to the crowd. They are excited about this.
Napa's just chilling.
He's just waiting around, seeing if Evie's going to try to go for Robo here, but Evie wants nothing to do with it. He knows he's far behind. He does not want to be set further. Fervor and Thunderlords, the only keystones on the side of the red cannons this time. Very aggressive. Deathfire touching the brand, Grasp of the Undying there on your Shen. Bottom lane, Yutori pushing up right now, has taken control over the lane. And remember, this Varus, like you said, was banned from him in the last match, so we'll have to see why that was banned away and if he can manage to pull out the carry on it this time around.
You can get some pretty deadly combos with these two. If you can get a Varus ultimate into a Brand ultimate and the people get locked up next to each other, that's a death sentence right there. You're pretty much getting two kills. Top lane, though, there's no flash on Robo, and you can see here comes Tussle.
And this is kind of what we were talking about with you can camp Darius, you can gank him and make his life incredibly hard. Was not able to get another Decimate and try to go for an extra heal there to make that one happen. Does get himself brought down, so that's going to tie the game up 1-1. Both deaths on the top laners.
Yeah, and actually used the Decimate right before the gank came through. And now they're going to see Napon on the bottom side, so they know shove top lane. There's no TP available, and they might actually go for some turret damage here. Unsure, it's still pre-7 minutes, so it's kind of like, don't really want to. Turret has fortification on top side, so they're just going to back off.
Napon moving towards the bottom side here.
They have to have some idea that he's around here because they saw him at the Raptors.
Yeah, they knew he was at the Wraith camp.
Yep. Going to go for a gank here. Dude walking up, and they're like, all right.
Volley on silence. There comes your Spiderling. Predicts the cocoon, finds the damage, and Rampage's AD carry will fall to the gank from the Red Cannons.
And Napon not going to go down either there and doesn't even need the heal from BRTT. Minions, though, kind of on him.
The minions smack him around a little bit.
Yeah, you can see him having a giggle there. It's like,
it's like, whoops, oh well.
Crowd's got his name in their mouths.
They know exactly what he's doing for this team right now. 2-0 on the Elise.
Yeah, this was great, because they both flash, and then he actually throws the cocoon, and that was beautiful.
Beautifully read, just like a book. Skritters himself away from danger. Then decides to hang out for a round and
yeah, 21 HP.
Smacked in the butt by the minions. 2-1 though. 2-1 for the Red Cannons. Both of them on the back of the jungler. Small gold lead for themselves.
That's pretty big though for the bottom side of the map because BRTT will have his arrow at level 6 pre when those flashes will be back up for both Dara and Yutori. So we could be looking at another engage around that time. Small window, but it's still one that you can operate in. And it's always about these windows having them and whether or not you take them.
And honestly, both these bottom lanes, sort of like what you mentioned, we're not seeing any more protect the AD carry this game. They're very explosive. You've got a Varus, a Brand, an Ashe, and a Malzahar. There's a lot of lockdown. There's a lot of damage. There's a lot of burst. It's scary for both sides.
Speaking of scary for both sides. Well, actually, you know what? Mostly scary for Evie.
I was going to say, this is just mostly scary for Rampage, considering that Darius is level 6 now. So you're constantly running the risk of having to fight this guy where he excels.
I believe they also saw Tussle there, who's level 6, has that power spike on Lee Sin, and that's what they're doing is they're pushing in. They actually have talkers here as well, and now they have full idea of what's going on.
Look at the CS discrepancy in the top lane, 49-22. Tussle's trying to hang around.
He's going
to
take it. What's he doing?
He goes in, tries to take it away. Napon actually going to be the one who secures it, but now the fight's going to be breaking out, and Urith Romo going to be taken down before he can do anything. Napon now having to try to turn this fight right back around. Ramune going to be taking a whole lot of damage. One more spider bite, grabbing the double kill. And Evie has to try to get himself away from this, but it is going to be a tall order. Flash out to stay alive.
They better be chanting Napon again after that.
Listen to it, man. You can hear it from there.
That was disgusting. I'm not going to spoil it till we see the replay again, but that was ridiculous. Evie comes through. Tussle has made some questionable decisions in the previous game. The kick and then the flash away from the Lulu that he made put his flash on cooldown where he's a big part of the engage. This here, the cocoon is dirty as hell. Tussle has Evie coming through. Cocoon hits Evie. He can't taunt. If you get a taunt there, you can hit 2 to 3 people potentially with that taunt. Save him, and then Napon still gets the repel to the Ahri. That's just bonkers play there on that Elise.
4-0-0, 8 minutes into the game, averaging one kill every 2 minutes. On this early game jungler, Runic Echoes completed on his tracker's knife. Gonna make his burst that much scarier. Tries to come bottom, doesn't really find the opportunity to do much. Cocoon will not find its way onto Dara, who was the intended target.
And this is so interesting because from what we've been hearing and seeing in Red's games previously, they usually only play to top mid and around that area when they have Yoda in the lineup as their sub mid laner, and it's Robo playing a carry, Yoda playing like a Katarina or a Cataprima or going for like a Cassiopeia. That's when they'll play around it and they'll leave BRTT to kind of fend for himself. This is BRTT and Jude fending for themselves, but Napon actually just came in, gave them a gank, got him a kill, and now he's just been camping top lane since the beginning of the game. That was a level 3 gank. That was beautiful stuff. He's been all over the map, but really making that top lane suffer.
Now we'll have to see how he can continue that as the game goes on. Level 6 is becoming available across the board. Everybody's got him now, and of course that's a little bit disadvantageous for Elise compared to most other champions, considering she doesn't have a big win button.
Yeah.
With that ultimate level being put into the spider form.
I will say, though, he did his damnedest. He did his Elise job to get ahead in the early game.
Yeah. Before level 6, he got 4 kills. So you're kind of feeling okay with not having this big game-changing, play pattern-altering ultimate.
I'll feel pretty good about that, yeah.
Yeah, that'll work. I'll take that. You can see level 8 on Robo, Decimate at level 4, Apprehend at level 2 to not only lower the cooldown of it, but like you mentioned previously, to build up the armor penetration.
Yeah, make sure that you have that just to shred it passively. And now, Napon just...
Oh, no.
Top again. Evie!
They've got talkers, too.
Yep. Hello.
Oh, Evie. I don't think this one's going to end too pretty for you, but
got him
Cocoon
again.
Finds him right at the end of the taunt, and the spider bite will grab kill number 5.
Robo.
100% kill participation, 100% of the kills for Napon. And the Red Cannons will look for turret first blood to really start to build this gold lead up to something significant.
Excellent playing to their win condition there. They actually only split the gold between Talkers and Robo. Whereas Rampage, in return, they get themselves that Drake. And I like this as well. There was actually a rotation here. Bottom lane sacked. Mid lane, they moved BRTT and Jude to cover mid. And now they have an inside track on top. Here comes Ramune, though.
Ramune wants to defend this, does not want
to
drop tier 2 for free. Ramune going to be CC'd into CC, so he can't really find anything else there, but they will hold the tier 2, which is very important.
And bottom lane, they don't feel confident enough to actually go for this. They don't have enough mana to go for a fight, and the next one that'll happen here. It looks like Yutori had popped his ultimate in some case, possibly gotten the flash from BRTT while all that was going on.
Both AD carries going for a Blade of the Ruined King again as well. Bilgewater Cutlass is complete. Bork, they are just now completed for Yutori. And as the laning phase gets closer to ending, remember, that's where we're going to be watching Yutori. That's where we're going to be looking to this guy to carry, is as we get further towards the mid game, as we get into the team fighting phase. If he can land some clutch Chains of Corruption, if he can find the damage and the Blight Stack detonations that he needs on this Varus, we want to see Yutori demonstrate why the champion was banned away from it.
Yeah, exactly. And also, like we said, he has some hype on him around getting out of lane phase. Once again, not a successful lane phase for him. I like this. Doing the Gromp while holding the blue.
Multitasking. We are 5-0, at least you can do that.
That's where you like hold the door for somebody else with your foot, and then you're doing something else. You're like, oh, don't worry about this. I got
Well, you're opening another door with your hands.
Yeah.
He's a spider. He's got 8 hands. Okay, you can't thinking emoji me. We can call them hands.
I was like, hey, you got 4 hands then. How about that?
All right.
You walk on your hands?
All right.
Your 2 bottom hands?
All right, fine, they're not hands. He's got 8 legs, but one way or the other, he's got 8 legs and 5 kills. 1 pair of boots now picked up as well to skitter around that much faster. A lot of times you do see mobility boots on the Elise. This time a sorcerer's shoe wants to continue having that combat capability.
Yeah, Mobis are usually like your first buy to help Snowball get you to 4 kills. He just went straight damage, wanted to duel the Lee Sin, wanted to have a better 2-on-2 instead of the whole I'll play the map better and get there instead of just outstats him. And so he's going with that route here, and I think he may even be going for a Haunting Guise as his second item here.
I mean, if it can help Snowball the game into a quick victory, no reason not to. And you can see as he cleared that Wraith Camp away, he also left the ward up that was being disabled by the control ward so as to not let his opponents know that's where he was.
Super clever there. Looking for a flash. They got the Summoner's Claw out of Ramune.
Ramune losing that escape mechanism. Snap-on sidesteps the Sonic Wave. Not really concerned about that too much.
The blue buff about to come up.
Into the enemy jungle. Wants to contest this blue buff potentially. Fires off the Scryer's Bloom. Able to see exactly where that Lee Sin is.
And now he has his bottom lane coming up.
Listen to the crowd just cheering.
It's all in.
Wanting to see yet another play being made.
Oh, on tussle.
Flash into more CC, into more damage, and domination from the Red Cannon's jungler. Talia Wall going to be used, though. Arrow comes out. Dara now going to be locked down to Yude as well. Dara going to be going down next. Yutori trying to get himself out of this fight.
Taunt.
A nice three-man taunt. But where's the follow-up? Evie is dunked.
Robo!
Robone is going to be tagged with five. There comes your double kill for Robo. And Rampage is ran over.
And even though Dude's down, he's got his arms up cheering his team on, getting the crowd hyped as well. Red get a gigantic lead off of that. See that one more time. Beautiful flash from Dude to set this up. CC lock. Tussle doesn't even get to play League of Legends there. And then that ultimate, so damn good, because what Napon does is he makes this little brand ultimate, only bounces twice, but eliminates the other target. If he was any other champion, he is stuck there, bouncing back and forth between them. And then Robo shows up off of the teleport. Murphy's in there. The officer does not go down.
Good stuff from the Red Cannons, up 5,000 gold 15 minutes in. Two turrets to zero, nine kills to three. This team, we went into this, Zyrene, saying this is one of the favorites, if not the favorite, from Group A, and they're demonstrating why right now in their second match.
And it's a hard group as well.
Right.
But now it looks like Supermassive might be the big competition for Red. And that's the last match of the day. So
yeah, we will see that one later on today at the very end of everything.
Even if the Red Cannons don't win this one, it's still like this matchup's going to mean so much. Rampage, though, they are in a position where they really are going to have to fight tooth and nail to get back into this game. Because now you have this Darius going off. You have this 6-0 and 300% kill participation. Absolutely crazy Elise running around the map. So you kind of have to be spooked everywhere you go.
Yeah, a little bit more than spooked. You've got to be practically quaking in your boots at this point if he skritters up towards you. They do manage to find themselves their first turret of the game. So along with that Cloudrake they got earlier, that now brings their objective count up to two in total.
Yeah, and look at that gold difference. The top and the jungle in sync there. Oh, dude.
Oh, wait.
Gets dropped by Tussle, but they put so much effort into that bottom lane gank. They got the kill. The turret went down, and now
you drop. Snap-on and Talkers. Trying to get themselves out of enemy territory while stealing away some of those chickens as well. Robo grabbing the tier 2 top lane that was almost taken down previously. Ramune walking into both hits of that orb from Ahri means he's going to be taking quite a lot of damage in that small trade, but the Spirit Rush was used.
Oh. Yeah, he had used it previously, was just using the other ones. Tussle hanging out. Kick back. There you go, the kick flash on the support. Dude making him work for it, though.
Yeah. Trying to get those juke boots on, walk himself out of that one, but it's not going to do a whole lot, as Rampage does secure their second elemental Drake of the game. So they got those going for them, if nothing else.
And it looks like Rift Herald started up for the Red Cannons. They want Robo to be a monster. He's split pushing like crazy. He's got this counter matchup into the Shen. He got camped early. He's done a hell of a job, and now they're kind of rewarding him here. There you go.
That's a really cool back animation, too. He actually flies. I've never got to see this skin before.
I don't have
gemstone Zyrene.
I haven't either. You waiting for that gemstone Skarner skin?
I actually really hope they don't, because I'll honestly just throw $500 at boxes to get. I really hope they don't.
They don't do it. But now he's got...
Now he's got his Black Cleaver. He's working on his Dead Man's Plate to make him that much more capable of getting into the fights and being where he needs to be. He's got Glimpse of the Void to make it so if you are in that 1v1 against him, you're going to have that much more trouble as Evie.
What else he got? Keep going.
He's got a really cool big space axe that's got an orange light in it. He's got everything he could possibly need to be a split push side lane threat in this game.
Yeah, pretty sure he duels anybody on the map right now. And Elise is kind of in the same boat. They have two people you really have to watch out for.
Robin is kind of annoying for him, but that's about it.
Tussle? Ah, Tussle was trying to go start something off there on Napon.
I mean, Tussle's doing all right for himself. Obviously, he's not 6-0-3.
Another Weaver's Wall. These have not been good from Ramune. This just seems like a rotational one here. Ahri top. Now there's two people bottom. They're going to lose this bottom turret. They're going to lose pressure. There's more tempo on bottom side. This from Rampage actually feels like a bit of a misplay. I don't think they can allocate fast enough. They're not going to get mid turret. They lose bottom turret. They lose pressure top. They lost map control completely.
Red Cannons finding the catch onto Evie, who's pulled back. Spirit's Refuge to keep him safe as he dashes his way out of trouble. Napon and Robo going to continue pushing up. Now look at how much damage Evie takes from Napon's quick burst combo. That is not what you would expect from a Shen.
Well, look at what he's built. He got destroyed by the top lane that's building physical damage in a Black Cleaver. Now this full penetration Elise comes up. You have nothing to really deal with that. You have the, you know, magic resistance from the Merc treads, but you're getting Merc'd at that point.
Full penetration Elise plus the Darius that Merc'd. Has extra. Ooh. Tussle grabbing himself yet another one. And that's what I was talking about. The guy's doing well for himself. Like, we're talking about the Elise the whole game because he's had a phenomenal runaway game. But things, all things considered, Tussle is still a part of 100% of the kills on his own team as well.
Both junglers 100% KP right now. And it's not like, oh, you know, only one kill or something. It's five for Rampage. They're still down 5,000 gold and they're finding picks. They just found two. And that's Ramune getting a really good knockback there.
Instant Dragon's Rage.
Yeah,
making sure he secures it.
Make sure he can't actually use his ultimate again and Spirit Rush away a second time. QSS purchased already for Tori, making sure he doesn't get locked up by Dude.
By Dude, by the cocoon from Napon,
yeah,
by Talker's Charm, by an arrow from BRTT.
Point. Great points, great, all very relevant.
All of these things can ruin his day and his team's game. QSSs are important.
They are. You don't have to tell me that.
Evie forced really far onto his back foot with defending, though. Pretty much just stuck underneath this tier 3 turret in the top side, trying to hope that Darius doesn't come anywhere near him so that he can continue to farm in a way that works out for him. Tussle and Evie both sort of walking past a ward here. Dara's Brand doing the same thing. The Brand not really having a whole lot of success so far this game. He's got mobility boots, but we haven't seen the crazy Brand damage output in the team fights that we would be expecting from the pick.
Almost saw something with the ultimate bouncing back and forth and almost getting him a pyroclasm double kill, but the fact that Napon was able to outplay that and go into the repel to break the bounces was actually perfect in that situation. Looking for a pick. Nice to send the Volatile Spiderling in. That'll check the bush for you so you don't have to face check it completely. And they get control of it.
Both sides just sidestep away from everything while Robo continues to push down in the bottom lane, 184 to 127 CS down there with his dead man's plate up. Ramune,
yeah,
not really finding many opportunities of his own this game either. 0-2 and 2 on the Taliyah.
He's looking for one right now.
They want BRTT. Instant flash away, but now he's in some danger. Having to fire the Enchanted Crystal Arrow, point blank range, Napon into the back line, but now gonna be bursted down. They finally squash the spider and get themselves a shutdown.
Gotta watch out though, here comes Talkers.
Talkers looking for that angle over the wall. Vulnerable health bars on both the enemy jungle and mid laner.
So Rampage are going for pick after pick. They aren't getting objective off of it. It's one of those situations where your bottom lane is pushed, your top lane is pushed, you gotta kill mid. Great, congratulations, you've got 300 gold, or I guess 450 counting the assist, but you don't get anything off of that. They blew flash and cleanse for a kill. They didn't blow it for a turret take afterwards. They're in fact gonna lose a turret. And that's what pushing your waves is all about. When you fight and you blow summoner spells, you get more off of those kills.
League of Legends isn't about killing the enemy champion. It's about killing the enemy Nexus. And you've got to be doing something to bring yourself closer to that when you find those kills.
Yeah.
A kill on its own really doesn't do too much.
Yeah, in solo queue, it definitely will help you out. But here in professional play, when people understand side wave management and when to fight, that was Red in a bad position mid, but they were caught out by a Taliyah that forced that issue. And they also had a Chain of Corruption land on Napon. But I will say that they were able to get nothing off of that as Rampage. They actually lost out on gold. And look at this right here. Here comes the Shen ulti onto Lee Sin. Looking to make the three versus one play if they can. Talker's flashing and Spear rushing away, but he walks right into the rest of the team. Rampage with a good full five-man collapse onto that enemy mid laner as Robo shows up, but he's not really going to do anything here.
They're going to push top on Rampage, but what's going to be the answer from Red? They got the Drake. They're going to go get mid turret. That tier two is already super low. Now the question is, what happens next? Is this a Baron call from Rampage where there's Talkers down?
If they go for it, they're going to be sacrificing quite a lot in the mid lane. Tier two has already fallen.
They're going to try. That's what it looks like. They started it up. They're spotted this whole time.
Robo wants to get
There's
into this
wall.
Fight. Arrow comes through, finds its way onto Ramune, who's also going to be locked down by Diude. Robo into the middle of the fight,
going
to be healing up, not able to do anything just yet. Diude falls second. A double kill for the Brand, and now Rampage are right back onto Baron. Low health bars could still be threatened. Napon wants to play in this fight if he can, secured by Tussle. Napon goes up into the air, tries to come back down, finds the kill to Ramune, but now what else can he even do? He goes one for one, and Rampage come up big.
And now Rampage, 1,500 gold behind, that's it. They are so close now, 10 to 10 in kills. This wall stops them from going up and around, so they have to come through this area. Robo walks up, gets taunted. Ramune had the ultimate from Dude on him, but then the Brand ultimate, the Pyroclasm, and the fact that the W from Ramune, the Taliyah, came through and Seismic shoved them into the wall and over his E, put them in such a good spot with so much damage. And that was pretty close from Napon. He actually flashed to dodge Ebi there. Almost got the smite, but still just a little bit short against that Lee Sin.
And honestly, that was a statement, if nothing else, about the mental state right now of Rampage. We talked going into this game about how they've got to have a quick turnaround after their first loss, make sure they got their heads on straight in this game. Things have looked bad for them for a long time, but they were able to make the right calls and find that victory that has now put them back in the driver's seat. Robo and Napon getting into a little bit of a scrap here against Tussle, who finds the kick on Robo, knocking him back. Stun not going to find its mark onto Robo as now Tussle continues to try to escape. Find the damage on the Napon as well. The redemption may not be enough to keep him alive here, but it will. Barely keeping that jungler going from 6-0 to 7-2. Napon's lost a bit of that momentum he had.
Yeah. Slowed down a bit, but that's the Elise. You set up your lanes for the early game. When you build the penetration, you're trying to become another threat, though, for your team. Right now, that macro play was just off. Talkers got caught. Talkers got caught in the top lane from a great play from Tussle and Ebi to flank, and then he tried to outplay by not going backwards toward his turret, but instead out towards the Baron, where he ran into two more members of Rampage. That was what really started that snowball to get that Baron in a position from a macro play perspective.
And now that Baron is still up and running on Rampage for another minute and a half, they will continue to enjoy control over the game for the first time this entire game.
Absolutely, they started off on such a rocky start. It was a 4-0 at least at the very beginning of the game. You're talking before level 6. The bottom lane got crushed, the top lane got crushed. It's almost a flame horizon of 100 CS here for Robo, who's been having a hell of a game and has had so much help. But they're staying in this. Dara, Yutori, and Tussle in the team fights have been so good.
Now Ebi finding himself caught out. The chain CC coming in pretty strong. Guardian Angel almost certainly going to be popped here. Tries to use Stand United to channel the shield at least. Weaver's Wall
nice
comes
cut.
In. Robo going to be bursted down. It's a 1-0 so far. Volley fired off. Ebi is so incredibly low.
Tussle.
He does have the ability to get back and TP back into the fight.
Exactly. Tussle has his kick flash. They're just looking for position on the mid lane here. He didn't take that one, good sign, but now he's looking for more.
Tussle
going in.
We're gonna find a kill on the Napon, and the burst is in, making up for the early game discrepancy by showing up as big as he can here in the mid game.
You build penetration, it goes both ways there.
Yeah.
That guy, no armor in sight, now has an arm guard. Look at this, looking for Dara.
Dara and some danger, but now Talkers
chain.
Is the one who's gonna be locked down. The damage coming in, unstoppable for Tussle.
Got godfisted there. Ramune looking for Diude.
Diude in retreat, but the threaded volley comes in, the damage comes out, and Dara comes up on a rampage. Ramune now having to retreat, goes for the taunt. Evie's grabbing the kill onto BRTT. Robo now trying to defend, but there's four dead on the side of the red cannons.
And Brazil is falling apart. Rampage got themselves back in this game off of a Baron, a misplay from Talkers, and a macro mayhem.
Now, can they do anything else with this? Rampage, they've got 10 seconds before Diude is back up and alive.
Defense from Robo and Napon will hold the line.
Oh, that's not going to be done. What? There's still Robo looking to go right back into the fight. A double kill. He's going to be able to make it a triple for sure right here. Cutting him down. Keeping hope alive for the Brazilian team.
Robo top again. Flashes in, makes sure that he's completely good to go. This game is not over. He's teleporting to try and push.
Teleporting into the enemy base onto the tier three. Now you can hear the crowd, hear the chants. Robo, breaking down the tier three turret, going for the inhibitor itself. Yutori and Ramune both up. A lot of range, a lot of power between these two. Not really a situation Robo excels at dealing with, and he's forced to retreat.
I gotta try to reset the map. 20 seconds until that Drake is up. Gets one. Actually misclicks there. Meant to click on Evie for the second one, and actually hit him, applied the stacks, and then ulted the wrong person. So that could have been a clean three and a possibility of a movement speed burst afterwards because of Black Cleaver to continue chasing. But it took him an extra second, and he gets slowed down.
Either way, Red Canids were in a situation where it looked like they might just be losing the game. And we've once again reset ourselves.
That's the thing. Even though I'm talking about the misplay there, it is good to focus on the fact that he had the balls to go for that. You can't be scared on this Darius. Ever since level one, shoving in, he's in a gankable position, doesn't matter, takes the trades.
That's not the kind of champ it is. You can't be afraid playing a juggernaut, you've just gotta go in. Dragon claimed by Rampage. Third one of the game for them. No more elementals will spawn, only elders from here on out, so yet another big objective to fight for these guys. Robo bagging himself away, does not want to be threatened by the range of these two for now, not without the rest of his team nearby.
Takes stock of the items really quickly. Dara has that penetration now, can actually deal some damage to these tanks.
Rampage just deciding to put some damage onto this turret.
Yeah.
Out the minion wave there at the start. Tussle will tank that one up, lose about half his health for it.
Top lane is going to be Ahri versus Shen here as well. The Talkers has no way to join his team except for a flat back, whereas Evie
can, but he's also got to be careful because he could be charmed out of it very easily.
Yeah, but I feel like Talkers gets beat in this one-on-one if it's actually a straight-up trade every time taunts up. It's not like a Gunblade Ahri, right? He doesn't have that regen. He has the passive, but was enough. Nice wall there. This is what we're looking for from Ramune.
Talia wall for zoning potential.
No, but they don't actually put up.
Not going to give him a lot.
Yeah.
Tori is pretty low. They don't want to risk that. Any big mistake here could result in tragedy for either team. Both wanting to make sure that they aren't putting themselves in a spot where you look back and you watch the replay afterwards and say, we lost because I made that call. But Evie now in a spot where he might just be soloed out by Talkers, who flashes over the wall and grabs the kill.
I don't know what he's doing there. He's walking back through a very obvious path, and he saw that the Ahri was there. He had healed up enough off of his passive, enough spell rotations, and he gets caught.
A free death on the side of a Japanese top laner.
Great catch there. Talkers, he was responsible for the first Baron going over to Rampage. He might be responsible. Hold on, though.
Oh, but Talkers, if he gets caught out here, that might be just as big. They're able to grab the kill onto him.
Oh,
now back
in.
Into the pit. Tussle going to be pulled in. He's crushed before he has a chance to try to steal this one away. Baron going to be taken low. Smite secured. And Robo loses the GA at the very end. The brand passive explosion.
They're trying to close in. Rampage, three members versus four. There's actually a Baron-empowered recall. He's going to get back.
He got out. What a smooth criminal. Comes right back to life and just dips before Rampage can cut him off.
What's the catch tool here? I don't think you really have one for Rampage unless there's a severe outplay.
Ramune having to pop his own cleanse there. Yutori kiting backwards, utilizing the lifesteal between the Mercurial Scimitar and the Blade of the Ruined King to keep his health topped off. Red Canid still having to deal with super minions marching down the mid lane. They'll get there in time to prevent any real damage to the turrets, and the inhibitor respawns.
And Robo's now at that point where, as a jungler, you're just proud of your baby. Like, you camped this guy
good
early.
Good job.
You're like,
I raised you right.
That was some good investment. He got Robo some early kills, got him that first turret, and then opened him up, got him a Rift Herald. Now, that pull over the wall on Tussle. Tussle was not expecting to get yanked through the wall there with the apprehend from Robo. Put him in a really bad spot, got just guillotined, and then it was pretty much a smooth pickup from there. But the exit from Robo as well, pretty stylish.
Changed a 50-50 into a 99-1.
Speaking of 100-0, Tussle?
Tussle just got absolutely deleted in that last engagement. But now, 33 minutes in, 31 kills between the two teams, still only a couple thousand gold separating them. Baron live for another 2 minutes or so. Red Cannons would love to make an actual move with this, but right now they seem to be grouping up in mid,
yeah,
just getting themselves accelerating.
Well, they're going to push for this mid turret, possibly bottom, whereas Rampage, it looked like they were focusing bottom slash mid, but there's no control of this side of the map for Red, so they won't check it. They don't want to go down there. Instead, they'll play to the mid, which is the central part of the map. It's so important when you're doing dances between Elder or you have a Baron, control the center part of the map. And it looked like Rampage weren't even going to contest them for that. All right.
At least
Yay!
They know. At least they know.
That was
fantastic. Yeah. If you're going to Zonya's in the middle of nowhere, at least have your team back you up.
Yeah. Everybody else pop their Zonya's too. We don't have it.
Well, throw your emotes. All right, we can do that much.
Got him. But still, doesn't have that Zonya's. I don't know if that's an enormous deal here. It depends what the fight comes down to.
That is a big Darius.
It is.
Elixir of Iron is such a fun item because it makes you big.
I love it.
I wish more items in the game did that. Just every tank item you build actually makes your character bigger.
And welcome to Zach.
Yeah, see, if everybody worked like Zach, you could just have a giant Shen running around or something.
Tank Either rework, way. Get on it.
Tank rework, there you go, goals.
Top turret had already taken some damage previously. You remember when Talkers was up here? And this turret gonna put the
Honestly,
last
Honestly, that cannon
shots.
Minion could do it.
Boom!
Kaboom! All right, we've got vulnerable inhibitors in the bottom lane and the top lane.
Robo.
Red Cannons wanting to end this game with the pressure they've built from this Baron power play.
Yeah, bottom lane got shoved up. Robo had to blow his flash, but Talkers also getting caught
there. Talkers in some trouble.
Taunt.
Flash into the taunts, able to find the kill. Now Robo has got to be careful to not fall as well. Dara going to be pulled in.
Can he get counter kills?
Stunts and damage coming in very quickly. Another shutdown goes their way. The mid lane inhibitor turret will fall as Evie and Tussle try to find more kills
here. The wall.
The Taliyah wall going to be flashed over. BRTT looking to make the outplay here. Ramune going to be eating a lot of damage from those auto attacks, having to get himself away. Diude now jumped on and brought down. It's three dead on the side of the Red Cannons. Elder Drake is up. One inhibitor down in the base of Rampage. It is there in the top side.
Yeah, I feel like you take everybody but Ramune and you bring them to Elder now. You have 20 seconds on Talkers, 24 on Robo. He may be able to TP in, but dude can't set up vision because he's dead for even longer than that. And that would be a blind Elise checking as long as you sweep this.
And Brand actually helps you take this very quickly as well.
The Liandry's Torment, the Blaze actually giving so much damage there. That'll be Elder on a Rampage that has three Drakes. They were losing a lot of this game, but they were able to secure a lot of those Drakes for themselves.
Three out of four this game means that Elder Drake burn is going to be 180 over the course of 3 seconds.
And it'll be a 180 in this game as well because Rampage, the beginning of the game, they were trading turrets for Drakes and back and forth. And then eventually, now it's finally paid off. They have this window of time that will overlap a little bit with when Barrett comes back up in a minute and 55 seconds, where now they have so much time to use this buff, take a fight, or get enough pressure to set up the Baron and relieve their base, which has an inhibitor down.
Guardian Angels up for both top laners for the next fight. So expect to see them going in even more bravely than usual. Nothing to lose, everything to gain. Except you could lose the game.
Yeah, that's true.
That's always a little bit of an issue for both these sides as Robo's going to be caught out here.
That's not where he is.
Stop him, but now he finds himself on top of Robo, which is not exactly where he wants to be. Still chasing him down, though.
Trying to buy time because the rest of his team is running down mid. They're trying to run it down mid, trying to get an inhibitor.
Robo's saying, look, I'll trade me for these inhibitors. It does not matter.
The play
and the call from the Red Cannons is to go for the inhibs.
Robo understands. It's a marathon, not a sprint. Sure, you can taunt to him, but this guy, man, he's just jogging the whole mile.
Great play from Robo to get out of what looked like would have been a certain death.
Played it right. A lot of people have the tendency to want to go back to where their team was, but I will say that the Red Cannons, the rest of the team, also provided pressure for him to recover, because that
it was a
catch-
team escape, is
exactly.
what it was. It wasn't
22.
Just Robo.
They put him in a catch 22 for Rampage. If you're killing Robo, you're losing your base. If you don't kill Robo, then, well, you got nothing off
now
that.
Now you feel really bad.
And you're probably getting that middle inhibitor down as well.
They did just barely miss out on taking the mid inhibitor on the side of the red cannons. They needed a couple more auto attacks to finish that one off.
Yeah, and right now, if you are RPG, if you're Rampage, 18 seconds on that Baron. There may be some overlap here between that Baron, the Baron spawning, and your buff. You only have a few more seconds on it. They haven't found the fight with it. They're going to try to go for it while they have that true damage burn.
You got to make something out of this.
Ramune's in a position mid to push and then possibly cut off. We'll see how he treats the Taliyah wall here.
All right, TP used.
Yeah, he's got Taliyah wall positioning.
Heavy going into the fight.
He's cutting him off.
Ram the Ramune is taken down. BRTT grabbing the kill on that one, and that is a very big pick.
They're going for broke here.
And brought low, taken down, but now they're in a 4v5. They got to be careful about this one. Dara grabbing the stun onto Napon. More damage coming out there. Evie able to grab the taunt onto two. Yutori in the very back of the pit. Going to be locked down. Cleanses his way out of it. Able to find
Yutori.
Attack damage. Able to bring down two. Not quite able to find number three. Evie now going to be shredded. BRTT and Robo just waiting. The last man standing. Evie on the side of Rampage. Now tasked with defense.
It'll
for the next 45
you.
Seconds.
The bleed interrupts it. He has to channel that twice. Gets back. But now... exposed inhibitors. I don't know how much he can actually defend this. BRTT played that so well, getting the kill there onto Ramune.
If nothing else, this is surely three inhibs. Red cannons making Rampage's life nigh impossible from this point. Robo, although he doesn't do a ton of damage to the inhibitor, he'll do enough to bring it down. And BRTT will quickly take out the third there in the bottom lane. Evie doing whatever he can along with Ramune to try to clear out these super minions. And luckily for these guys, just in time to avoid the triple inhibitor, double super minion death sentence, the top lane inhib respawns.
Yeah, Ramune went for a clever wall there, but then look at this, Yutori, that guy's kind of stuck. He has to flash over the wall. Talkers is there. Talkers flashes to try and get a charm, but right as the apprehend comes through, Yutori flashes after QSS to reset and get away from it, but then he gets a counter kill. But it's actually not enough to run away with the fight. But that fight, they didn't have an exit strategy. Ramune got hit. He was kind of the way they get out scot-free. He uses the wall, and then he's supposed to cover the area with W and E. But then the fact that he went down means that Yutori's now in the back of the pit, should be in the front of the pit, but he can't be there anymore because he doesn't have anybody to run sweeper or defense.
Rampage still has Baron buff up on only Evie. They could utilize that if given the opportunity, but they're so far in defensive mode now with two inhibitors once again down. But they're not really going to see that opportunity coming to fruition. Wards being placed down in their own side of the jungle, just trying to keep control over the map in any semblance that they can, any way that they can. But BRTT and the rest of the red cannons are wanting to push and end this game. Two inhibitors down, one inhibitor exposed. Robo on the front line, Guardian Angel up. Napon also Guardian Angel up.
Yeah, still, crucial summoner spells available for engage. Tussle has his flash, Evie has his flash. So you have the taunt flash, and you have the kick flash. Looking for how these fights play out. It's about those mechanics, it's about those decisions.
Wall comes through, BRTT gets himself onto the safe end of that wall just in time. Not going to be caught out so far there. Napon going up into the air with the rappel, comes right back down. Redemption used to make sure they stay healthy. And with Taliyah wall gone, that's a big scary tool on the side of Rampage no longer available.
They have to pull the trigger soon. That bottom wave pushing on their turret. That's a flash taunt.
Oh,
it misses!
And he goes for the flash taunt and can't find it. Now he's going to be juggled back right into the rest of the team. Ramune going to be locked down next to you into the back line. Going to be in some trouble as Tussle is back there.
Yutori.
Containing three. Grabs the kill to BRTT. Dara and Ramune trying to hold the line, but the rest of the team has fallen. And Robo will run them down. A killing spree for the top laner. And the home team from Brazil will go 2-0.
It wasn't pretty. It wasn't clean. It was back and forth. But they're going to take the victory that they deserve and go 2-0 in day one.
The crowd goes wild for the Red Cannons as they bring down the Japanese representative at MSI and claim their second victory on the day.
And the crowd on their side, 100%.
Oh, you know it. These guys, every single time there were plays being made, you heard the chants coming from the audience. You can see everybody on their feet banging those Thundersticks together. They are ecstatic to see such a day one performance from their team.
The chants, Napon dominating that early game.
The cadence of it over and over and over again. Not only is that encouraging to your team, like you mentioned, you can see and hear and feel that happening around you when you're the opponent. And when you lose to something like that, and every single time they get you, there's that echoing around it. It's just that much more disheartening to play against and that much more encouraging to play with.
Exactly. So the Red Canids, that was a very back and forth game for them. It's one of those, are you not entertained at the end? Because that definitely was incredibly entertaining. We had the back and forth from them, but there were some key decisions there between both teams that ended up just not panning out exactly the way they wanted. Taunt Flash at the end, not lining up for Evie, but also there's still the possibility that that gets QSS'd. So it's a play that even if he had made it, may have not worked out in the first place.
Well, for more on those decisions and how the Red Canids pulled out their win, let's send things over to the analyst desk.
Thank you very much. Gentlemen, off the bat, I want to talk about the composition put together by Red Canids and kind of the execution of it, because it largely differed from what they put together in game one. This one a lot more pick-oriented with the Elise, Ahri, and the Ashe. And of course, Napon going big on that Elise, getting early kills.
Oh God, I hate the way the Shen played this early game out and not contesting the wave at all. He's at level two when he's starting to get dove there. Super easy dive for Napon to get up there and start taking over this game. Goes bottom just after that, gets involved in the bot lane as well, and the snowball is in full effect. Continues it with an early red contest now at 7 minutes, able to win this 3v3 skirmish and really just dominated the early game.
I love the fact the Red Canids played around exactly what we wanted to see them play around. We wanted to see Robo being put on the carry into the tank that we're expecting from Evie, and you could look to play towards that half of the map and start to get a snowball going. So many early ganks were just set up in the top half of the map. Evie wasn't able to make any of the level 6 Shen ganks that you would normally expect. They weren't able to make any plays with the Ashe down, or the Varus rather, down in the bottom lane. Like, this was an extremely difficult get-go for the side of Rampage.
I think an important thing to note, though, is that while the Red Canids got off to a good start, we did kind of see kind of that lull in the mid-game with control of the game, uncertain about how to go around, pushing their advantages, and it kind of resulted in a very skirmish-oriented game as a whole that went back and forth many times.
Right, we talk about Red Canids, for the most part, liking to run pick comps, and they have one here, but this is a little different where it wants to split up a little bit more into a more of a 1-3-1 than some of their other ones where they really want to ball up and really fish for those kind of picks. And once they started spreading out a little bit more, their vision control was not up to par, and it led to them actually being the ones who got picked off a number of times.
And this is where we really started to see some of the strengths of Tussle as well, because he was one of the main reasons as to why they were able to find so many picks. He was always roaming around the map. He wasn't really just sitting in lanes and wasting time. He was always with someone looking for these picks and always finding these small opportunities to get back into the game. And it was kill after kill after kill. And eventually, those picks resulted in a pretty big advantage.
I was going to say, one of Rampage's biggest opportunities to take this game came 24 minutes in. A pick on Ahri plus the Baron on the back end of it. They almost ended the game with this Baron.
And this is where we see one of those examples, right, where Tokkaz is moving up to the top half of the map without proper vision, without good setup from the rest of his team. Rampage are very quick to punish him for that, and then they transition into a Baron.
Right, and you see that even though they get the Baron, they also do a good job turning off, really well coordinated there, getting the Shen taunt, making sure that even though they're in this pit, they can't get destroyed by some of the AoE tools available on the side of Red Canids. And then after they get those cleanup kills, look back at the Baron and pick this up.
But I think it really was the story of vision in this game, as was just mentioned. I mean, even in that scenario there, there was no pressure anywhere else on the map. So RPG had the freedom to go 5 men into the top lane. Whereas if you had the Darius down there maybe in the bot lane and had established pressure elsewhere, it wouldn't have turned out in quite that way.
Right, I mean, that's the big thing is when you run that 1-3-1 with a lot of pickoffs, you want to get deep jungle vision, you want to push all 3 lanes and then kind of move between them, hoping to catch people out. And they never really synced up on that part of their game plan. And that's why whenever, you know, Tussle was able to find one of those picks, it wasn't that punishing, because sometimes that happens, but because you're pressuring everywhere, then you lose a top turret or something. And there you see the perfect example, 5-man topside, nothing going on in the bot or mid lane.
Now that replay goes in favor of RPG, but the game ultimately went in favor of the Red Canids. So let's go ahead and take a look at the next team fight that really put it together for them, 31-40.
And this is where Red Canids, they were able to get a
such
massive pick onto the top half of the map, onto Evie. The fact that Tokkaz was able to get that solo kill resulted in a 4v5, and Red felt confident enough to try and force this play. But the key thing about how this was all able to happen was because Rampage, with the Baron, overstayed too long in Red Cannon's base. They thought that they could end. There were too many low health bars. Robo gets himself a triple kill on the Darius, and they swiftly transition this into a stall phase where they can just wait for an opportunity, which they turn into a goal.
We talk all the time about gold graphs and what a good one looks like. This is not exactly how you want to win a game.
The heart rate monitor gold graph?
Not
like
quite the heart rate monitor. That's not what we want. Now, that said, we got to remember, we're in a best of one group stage setting. So 2-0 here start for the Brazilian team versus the 0-2 start here for the Japanese team. They're going to be feeling very comfortable, and it's going to give them a lot more freedom and confidence moving further through the group stage, whereas Rampage backs to the wall now. You got to start winning some games.
I mean, we talk about the importance of some cheesy picks maybe in a best of one. Here's an example where that Darius pick, even though it was the Elise, the one going off, it was set off the fact that they did not know how to play the Shen Darius matchup, really. He just conceded the whole wave early on, and then the top side of the map gets blown up over the next 10 minutes.
He died with 3 CS to 18.
Yeah.
At level 2, you have to contest that wave a little bit more. And so you see, if a person doesn't know how to play a certain matchup, you basically win the game off that, because it got really dicey in the mid game for them. But at the end of the day, a W is a W, and now they're looking great to get move on.
I'd also really like to see Rampage move away from this Taliyah. I feel like the roams have not been optimal. I feel like his impact and fights have not been great. And I am yet to see very much from this mid laner of Rampage. We talked at the start of the day about how I felt this could be an upgrade from the mid.
So far, not working out that way.
And so far, not that way.
All right, well, hopefully they'll take your advice and maybe switch it up in future games. We still got more games coming your way. When we return, OCE's Direwolves hope to topple Turkey's Supermassive. As we go to a break, though, you'll have to look, or you'll have a look, rather, at the journey of the Red Cannons to make it to the play-in stage in this year's edition of Eyes on MSI.
Ir para MSI e representar o Brasil em solo brasileiro seria, no mínimo, uma honra, acho que para qualquer pessoa que for. Ia ser uma experiência sensacional, porque naquele momento você é o Brasil e o Brasil está com você.